Star Trek did it first, and then Star Trek did it best.
The Enterprise is heading to Starbase 6 for a little R&R when suddenly Spock senses a great disturbance in the Force, as if a million voices cried out in terror and was suddenly silenced. Ha! That's right. Suck it, Lucas. At least when we go and remaster shit, we aren't making the Gorn shoot first. Anywho, apparently what Spock sensed was the Intrepid, a ship manned by Vulcans, being destroyed. And not only do we get to see Spock go all Ben Kenobi, but he also lays down some moral subtext for us.
Spock, how can you be so sure the Intrepid was destroyed? I sensed it die. But I thought you had to be in physical contact with the subject before.
Doctor, even I, a half-Vulcan, could hear the death scream of 400 Vulcan minds crying out over the distance between us.
Not even a Vulcan could feel a starship die.
Call it a deep understanding of the way things happen to Vulcans. But I know that not a person, not even the computers on board the Intrepid, knew what was killing them, or would have understood it had they known.
But 400 Vulcans?
I've noticed that about your people, Doctor. You find it easier to understand the death of one than the death of a million. You speak about the objective hardness of the Vulcan heart. Yet how little room there seems to be in yours.
Suffer the death of thy neighbor, eh, Spock? Now, you wouldn't wish that on us, would you?
It might have rendered your history a bit less bloody.
The Enterprise goes to investigate the Gamma 7A system where the Intrepid had been, because not only have they lost contact with the Intrepid, but with the entire star system. And that's when we see this thing! Yes, folks, it's a fucking hole in space. Kirk has a probe sent into it, and we are greeted by the most annoying sound in the world. So, suddenly McCoy reports that half the crew has become weak, and even some have fainted.
Can you handle it, Bones?
I'm giving them stimulus to keep them on their feet.
Yeah, here's a Red Bull and some no-dos. Now, get back to work. So with no answers as to what this hole in space is, Kirk does the logical thing and decides to fly into it. And all I can think is, man, I hope Starfleet has some good hazard pay, because you're bound to get some working on this ship. So as they enter the void in space, they find that it continues to suck them in when suddenly we meet this thing. What is that, you might ask? Well, apparently it's a giant amoeba, a single-celled organism, in space. Both McCoy and Spock want to take a shuttlecraft to study it, but not for scientific purposes. That's strictly secondary. No, folks, as with all things that James Tiberius Kirk encounters, his main focus is killing it. I think they missed that part in the intro monologue. So Kirk sends Spock, and not long after we lose contact with him, but not before he tries to relay a message about how to destroy the creature. But Kirk, being Kirk, figures it out all by himself and realizes that an antimatter bomb on the nucleus of this creature will destroy it. As they set the charge and back away, Spock reestablishes contact with the ship, and Kirk and Scotty use the tractor beam to get the shuttlecraft out of the amoeba, just as the bomb goes off, destroying the creature. And with the ship and crew well in hand, Kirk gets back to the real priorities of a starship captain.
Atlantic course for Starbase 6, ahead warp factor 5. I'm still looking forward to a nice period of rest and relaxation on some lovely planet.
So this episode is probably best known for the special effects of the giant space amoeba. Now, granted, this is probably not the best known of giant space monster thingies that Kirk encounters in the series, but the scene when the amoeba is revealed is always very much remembered by a lot of fans. Now, when they went back and they redid it for the remastering of the series, they didn't really do a whole lot with the amoeba. They did give it a little bit more of a 3D effect, but for the most part, the visual of it pretty much stayed the same. And it's telling that the optical effect master on the show got an Emmy for his really great work of just visual effects for the series. Now, one of the really interesting things about the episode is that you get to really see McCoy sort of step out of the role of being the country doctor. And really, he takes on more of a role of a serious biochemist, of a real scientist, in his enthusiasm and excitement of wanting to go and study this giant amoeba, even though Spock winds up being the one that Kirk picks in the end. Overall, the writing is very good. The actors all have their own really great parts in this episode. But again, it's not one of the most memorable episodes, and it's overshadowed by other episodes which sort of follow the same formulaic design that Star Trek tends to fall into. That being that there's a mystery, we discover it's some giant space thingy, the ship is in danger, Kirk saves the ship. That being said, it's not a bad formula. It has been a formula for success for a lot of episodes in the series, but you get the sense that this is not the best example of that. It's good, but it's not the best. And all that I'm also watching, I'm also wondering how other captains in different series would have handled the same situation. Of course, especially the biggest comparison with Kirk is going to be Jean-Luc Picard, who is the next captain in the series. So maybe that's my question today for you guys. If you could serve with any captain of any starship, or in case of DS9, space station, in the Star Trek universe, who would it be and why? So let me know in the comments down below. Overall, I'll give the episode 4 out of 5. Again, like I said, it's a good episode, but as far as giant space thingies that they wind up fighting episodes go, this is not the most memorable. Probably the most memorable is going to be the Doomsday Machine and that sort of genre. But again, it's a good episode, and it's a fun watch. And again, the Amoeba is just visually stunning. Even the original series version is very, very good as far as how special effects go for the 60s. And so if you enjoyed this episode, make sure you hit the like button. Remember to share it with your friends, Facebook, Twitter, however you do it. If you want, you can subscribe right here if you haven't already. And last episode's going to be right over here. And next time we'll be watching A Private Little War. So we'll see you then on the challenge. Bye, guys.